Good afternoon, everyone. Friends, probably for some friends, good morning. Probably almost good morning. And good afternoon, everyone, including students. I will make a presentation about probabilistic resistance, fatigue resistance analysis for riveted joints. And for this purpose, I will use Monte Carlo simulation techniques. So this work has been already published. I will give you the details of the publication. And this was possible, this work, by the collaboration of other people, including the chairman, José Correia, and a former student of mine that finished his master thesis some years ago. I'm a professor at the Faculty of Engineering from the University of Porto, Portugal. Currently, I am working at the mechanical department and specifically in the materials and manufacturing division of the mechanical department. You can see my details, my affiliation websites here. So I also belong to the research center in EGI, which is our interface from the university to the industry. You can check details in this website address. So concerning the outlook of my presentation, I will make some comments about motivation. So it will be the introduction. Then I will refer the objectives of this work that I will transform it in a kind of lecture. I suppose that most of you are master and PhD students. So let me try to make a lecture for you. So I will share you some results from past research in a kind of lecture format. So I will address the objectives, then I will make some considerations about Monte Carlo algorithm concerning the SCN field computation. Afterwards, I will refer some modeling, some fatigue modeling aspects. In this research, we adopted this kind of two-phase modeling approach based on fatigue damage evolution, starting with crack initiation and afterwards fatigue, the macro crack propagation. Then I will describe the application, which is a riveted joint, a very simple riveted joint, but the idea is to give you a framework that could be applied to other details, structural details, more complex details, for example. Then I will present some results of the Monte Carlo simulations, and I will discuss with you those results. And finally, some concluding remarks that I will share also with you. So the main purpose or the main motivation for this activity is related to structural reliability. You have already listened this morning, my colleagues talk about structural reliability. I will just touch small or general aspects of this topic, just to mention afterwards where we will work in this lecture. But as an overall idea, structural reliability looks for definition or for a probabilistic definition of the structural safety. And in a very simple way, we are just making a comparison between the applied loads on the structure that could be stochastic, and in the other side we have the resistance. In this case, I will talk about fatigue resistance of the structure, which is also which also suffers from many sources of uncertainty. So for this structural reliability, we need to address both loads or actions and the resistance in a probabilistic way. We need to reach the probability of failure, and using this probability of failure, we can compute the reliability. Calculations can be performed for some cases in an analytical way, for many cases we don't have such kind of closed form solutions, because, for example, we don't know exactly the distributions for the different sources of parameters or aspects that influence, for example, the actions or the resistance. So we need some kind of numerical procedure, and the Monte Carlo simulation appears as a very simple, very attractive way to handle this situation that I am trying to describe, the impossibility to derive analytical closed form solutions. So this is the first aspect of this lecture. Second one, the application. So why I'm so interested, because it's a group that are working in this kind of riveted joints. As you know, we have a lot of old bridges still in operation in Europe, America, I'm sure around the world, we have a lot of these old structures. Most of them, or many of the many, are still in operation, and I would say some of them we don't want to destroy, to replace, because they are actually very nice architecture pieces. So they are in our cultural heritage. So we want to preserve them, but for that we need to perform deep investigations in order to assure adequate structural reliability for those structures. Many of them, as the one you can see in this slide, is a landmark in Porto City. And in the last, I would say, 15 years, this old bridge, centenary bridge, was upgraded just to allow the tram light metro to cross the Douro River in the upper deck. So this structure is all riveted. So we need to understand what is the current safety and the future safety evolution for this kind of bridges. I would also say that these riveted connections are no longer used for bridges. They are still used for other kind of structures, like some in aeronautics. But for bridges, they are no longer used, because we are now using preloaded bolts, also welded joints. But since we have a lot of cases with these riveted connections, we need to address some issues that we have with rivets, namely the clamping stresses. The preload on the rivets is not fully controlled. Typically, rivets work in shear, and we have a small clamping effect. Also, we have problems because about friction, surface contact conditions. They are not, for sure, deterministic, and also they could evolve during the history of the bridge, due to, for example, corrosion or other degradation of the coatings. We have also some important uncertainty as regards materials, because in many cases we are talking of very old materials with a lot of impurities, lot of slag inclusions. I remember this lecture, the Grzegorz lecture this morning. He talked about something about puddle iron. So we are in many cases working with puddle iron, which was a kind of beginning construction material that was later replaced by the constructional steels that we are using nowadays. So, take into account these aspects of friction, clamping stresses, material properties, uncertainties, we need to address this using probabilistic tools. So that's one main point of this lecture today. Just for in terms of introduction, just saying that typically structural engineers are more interested, they enjoy to use global approaches for these fatigue problems, because they are simpler to apply, they require simple stress calculations, and also they simplify because the process of the handling the uncertainty, because they don't distinguish the different sources of uncertainty, they rely on statistical analysis and also on a significant number of testing data, which many times are very expensive. Using representative details and testing a lot, we can derive by statistical means average SEN curves. We can define also design or characteristic curves for design purposes. This is a global approach, and it suffers, it has some advantages, as I told you before, but also it suffers for many weaknesses, like we don't understand exactly what is contributing for this scatter. We need a lot of testing. The tests on structural scales are very expensive. The design codes try to solve this, applying very conservative safety margins. Many times we are designing using such kind of over conservative, SEN approach, like the one foreseen in Eurocodes. Today I will discuss an alternative to the global approaches, which is the local ones. In those local approaches, we try to understand better what is actually the fatigue damage. So we can say that fatigue damage will be could be considered as a process of crack, of macro crack initiation, or engineering crack initiation, plus fatigue crack propagation. So this was already explained to you this morning in the first lecture by Correa. So in this research, we will address the fatigue life, take into account these two contributions, the crack initiation and the crack propagation. Of course, we can discuss a lot about this, okay? But I would say that this is a very common approach already. This is more or less well accepted already in the literature. And I'm saying that because other people, other groups try to address this fatigue damage using exclusively fatigue crack propagation, since the dislocations dynamics till the final failure. So in this case, I'm just orienting you for this two-phase approach. So we will look separately for the crack initiation and for the crack propagation. So the objectives of this lecture will be to explain you a framework that could be applied for generation of probabilistic SEN fields for riveted joints, but this could be extrapolated for or applied to other cases as well. We will use, as I told you, local approaches. And since the complexity of the problem will not allow, as far as I know, any closed form solution, we will adapt use Monte Carlo computation algorithm to transform what we will say as kind of deterministic problem into at the end into a probabilistic SEN field. As I told you, I would say that this work was performed by a former master student, Sanchez, some years ago, as you can see. And you can find details in this publication of what I will present you today. So the first important point is to understand how this Monte Carlo algorithm could be used for the SEN field computation. And this is my, I think, the first important aspect of our lecture, to understand these five phases of the algorithm. And I will apply or explain in detail later on how we applied each one of these stages in our problem, using different tools, including numerical ones, for example. So first of all, we need to have a physical model of the, this case, for the fatigue problem. And this could be a deterministic one, okay? So that's what we will do. We'll try to define a very simple, I would say, fatigue model for our riveted joint. And then looking for that model, you should look for different inputs that we need to define. And for them, for those inputs, some of them are really probabilistic. So we need to define for each input their statistical distributions, okay? This could be not easy to establish. So sometimes we need some kind of empirical approaches, some common sense sometimes. I will explain you later on that. So I will show you a kind of engineering perspective of this SEN field computation. Then after identification of the inputs of the models and their distributions, we will make a lot of computations. The idea is to run a lot of computations based on estimations for each input. So we have these inputs that are random variables. We need to make some estimations for each input and combine them in the deterministic model. With that, we will compute the outputs of our model. For example, the total fatigue life. If we repeat that for a long number of simulations, we will at the end reach some distribution for the our outputs. So that's what I am saying, the aggregation of the results and analysis of those results. So this basically, and in a simple way, is the algorithm that we will explore during our lecture. So now let's go back to the deterministic fatigue model and also discuss how we can, we will also look for the deterministic model and identify the sources of uncertainty in that deterministic model. So, as I told you before, we will use this two-phase fatigue approach, crack initiation, crack propagation. And for the crack initiation, we will use a local strain approach. And as regards the crack propagation, we will use fracture mechanics. For this, the previous lecture from Jegors was very comprehensive. We will use a very simple piece of the previous presentation of Jegors. So, concerning the uncertainty of our model, I would say that we will have manufacturing sources of uncertainty. I would say the clamping stresses on rivets, it will depend on the quality of the riveting process, also the quality of the surfaces, which could be a result of the manufacturing, will also produce some uncertainty. Friction and clamping stresses work together, and we should account for these two parameters in our simulation. We have also material uncertainties. So since we are talking of a two-phase fatigue model, I would say that we will have some uncertainty on crack initiation resistance, and also we will have some uncertainty on fatigue crack propagation resistance. So we need to address these two aspects. Then we will have uncertainties in the crack initiation criterion. This is, I would say, a modeling uncertainty. Is not, well, this is a limitation, for, I would say, from our knowledge about the modeling. Because there is no consensus in the literature about the definition of the crack initiation dimension. Many people talk about 0.1 millimeters, others 0.25, mostly people from US where they use inches. So 0.25 seems to be more appropriate for them metric, for their system, unit system. So you can see the kind of decisions behind this definition. So I would say this is a modeling uncertainty that I will cover in our simulation. I think I have to speed up a little bit because it passed already half hour. So I would say concerning the local approaches for fatigue crack initiation, this morning Correa talked about deterministic approaches. I copied from his slides, he apologized me for that, some equations. But I would say, okay, you can use these equations for each one of these equations can be used for our computation. And we need to identify for each parameter, for each, I'd say, property involving these equations, we need to account, we need to define it as random variables, define their distributions in order to be able to compute in a probabilistic way at the end, the crack initiation. Okay, this could be done. I will not follow this because I have another option that is, for example, probably more attractive for crack initiation. But I would say, okay, we need to identify all these parameters. We need to guess their estimations for the probability distribution functions. And we need to be sure or about the possibility of correlation between those parameters. Sometimes if we adopt independent distributions for each one, at the end we will have an overestimated scatter because some of them are correlated variables. So for our research, we use a model from a friend of us, of mine, two friends of mine, Cantelli and Castillo, that some years ago they developed a way to describe the strain life data in a probabilistic field. So they went to the variable distribution and they found a very interesting transformation parameter that allows to use the variable distribution to represent this V variable, can be used to represent the complete probabilistic field, I would say SEN field, for in this case for the strain life relation. So this model involves five parameters. Three parameters are from the variable distribution, the location, the scale, and the shape parameters. And two other parameters are these two asymptotes that can be, one of them has a very clear physical meaning. It relates to the fatigue endurance limit. So if you are interested in this model, I would recommend to check this publication by the authors of the model, where you can also see that they developed a free software, pro-fatigue software, that allows the identification of the model constants using maximum likelihood techniques, constraint least squares method. There is a possibility of including runouts in the computation of the probabilistic SN field. And at the end, you can derive the parameters of the model, and you can get this kind of representation, or in an alternative way, you can also plot this cumulative distribution function for the V variable. Take into account this relation for the V variable, which involves the product of the life and the strain amplitude, you can transform this cumulative distribution function in, for example, the distribution function for the fatigue life given some strain amplitudes. Okay, now I will talk about fatigue crack propagation modeling, and I will not teach you anything new because previous lecture was very comprehensive about fatigue crack propagation models. For our purpose, we select the most simple model. Of course, we can afterwards apply our framework or the proposed framework to more complex crack propagation models. So we can compute the fatigue crack propagation life integrating the a kind of a known fatigue crack propagation law. So that could be very complex, as you know already. We need to understand what is the initial crack size, and this will be considered in our approach random variable, and the final crack size, in our case, we assume it as a deterministic parameter. You can discuss that, okay, probably it depends on toughness, that is not constant. But I would say that this is a less important parameter when we are talking of long crack propagation, because toughness or the limit size of the component would not produce a significant difference in the number of cycles. So, take into account the well-known Paris equation, we can integrate this equation. And of course, for this, we need the delta K solutions. And again, we can use analytical cross-form solutions that there are many available in the literature for many cases. However, for riveted joints, I don't know. I don't know closed-form solutions. So I would recommend numerical methods. For that purpose, in our research, we use finite element modeling, and we use the virtual crack closure technique. That is, an energy-based approach for the computational. We can, using this energy-based approach, we can reach the stress intensity factors for different crack configurations and components. So I forgot to mention there is a very nice review paper about these techniques. This paper is from Krueger, I think he's an American researcher, gives you a very nice overview of these techniques for calculations. Afterwards, we can transform it into stress intensity factors. So we use that kind of approach to compute the delta K solutions for our riveted joint. Afterwards, we can integrate the crack propagation law. And for this purpose, we will consider C random variables, the C coefficient from the Paris law, the exponent, and the initial crack size. Concerning the definition of their random their distributions, I would say that C and M parameters, we can try to guess independent distributions for each one. However, if you do that, you will see that you will reach a very overestimation of the crack propagation scatter. The other option is to define one parameter like C as a random variable, and the M parameter could be correlated with C. This is our recommended in literature. However, in our case, since we don't have too much data in order to find that correlation between C and M, we define C as a random variable, and we fix M as the average value of our experimental data. Now I will show you the workflow for our analysis, and you can see here how we perform this, how we applied for the riveted joints this technique. So we start with an estimation of we should define different stress levels applied to our rivet joints. And for each stress level, we need to define friction coefficient, the clamping stresses. Using this information, we need to perform numerical simulations to get the stress intensity factors. With this information, we can go to the crack propagation using, again, take into account some uncertainty on the crack, on the C coefficient of the Paris law, and also on the crack initiation size. In this case, the blue boxes are for the deterministic parameters we assume in our simulation. In the other side, we will compute the crack initiation using an elastoplastic analysis in order to compute the local strain in the riveted joints. For this, we explore different techniques, numerical elastoplastic approaches, and also some simplified approaches like elastic analysis plus analytical elastoplastic analysis, like Neuber approach. Using that, we were able to, using the probabilistic model from Cantelli and Castillo, we were able to generate crack initiation cycles. So you can here again see a summary of the model inputs in yellow boxes. We have the constant parameters, and for the model inputs, we need to define their probability distribution functions that will be based on experimental data and also on information from the literature. So regarding the K computation, I told you we use the VCCT, the virtual crack closure technique. And for the elastoplastic analysis, we use also the numerical model without any crack, just to compute the local strains using elastoplastic analysis, or to compute the elastic stress concentration factors that were applied afterwards in the Neuber elastoplastic analysis. Concerning the outputs of our model, we will check the propagation life, the initiation life, and the total life of the riveted joint. So some information about the riveted joint to be investigated. So this was a simple double shear riveted joint that was extracted from an old bridge from a city in Portugal, Esposende. We extract some material from this bridge and we perform some fatigue tests on the riveted joint. I would say that this material of this bridge was paddle iron. Then we derived this from fatigue tests of the riveted joint. We derived this SN curve. This is a global approach. We also analyze or test the material. So we perform strain life tests using smooth specimens for two strain ratios. And afterwards, we analyze those two strain ratios independently, and we found that they are not so different, so we can combine together, and we reach this probabilistic strain life field for the material. And using this field, we can obtain this probability distribution functions for different applied strain amplitudes. So this information will be very important for our computation algorithm. As regards, we also did some fatigue crack propagation tests, a few tests with CT specimens, and we derived the mean values for the parameters of the Paris equation. Afterwards, we did we applied here some, Monte Carlo techniques just to generate different values for the fatigue crack propagation rates. Assuming two options with C parameter constant and the exponent distributed according to the log normal distribution, or with C distributed according to log normal distribution and M constant. And we found that this second option was more consistent with the scatter we had in our experimental results. As regards the numerical simulation, since we need to perform the Monte Carlo simulations for a very long or very high number of simulations, at let's say 10,000 simulations, it would be, I would say, prohibitive to run for each simulation, for each individual simulation, to run the numerical model with elastoplastic analysis, with VCCT. So in an alternative to this, we use the numerical model to generate enough information, the numerical information, to allow us to use some fitting functions to generate, for example, the stress-intensity factors for any clamping stress of interest or any friction coefficient of interest. So that's the idea behind these numerical simulations, to give us information, enough information, to allow us to extrapolate or interpolate for the Monte Carlo simulations. So this is an overview of the numerical model. I will not explain all the details. You can check that on the paper. And I would say, in addition to what I have said before, that as regards the elastoplastic analysis, we test two techniques besides the elastic plus Neumer. We also test a full elastoplastic analysis using what I call the cycle by cycle, where we run a few load steps, loading and loading steps, or an alternative way was to use the twice yield method, that using just one load step and using an appropriate material cyclic curve, we can generate the data we want. So as regards the results, we, using the numerical simulation, we compute the stress intensity, the elastic stress concentration factors for various friction coefficients and clamping stresses on rivets. This information was useful for the elastic plus Neumer computation of the local strains. In this slide, I compare the results from the different techniques for the elastoplastic analysis, and just in kind of conclusion, this twice yield method was very efficient. This was a technique proposed by a friend of mine some years ago, Carl Mills from Lehigh, US, and we adopted this technique as our reference method. Then we were able to derive what we call the component cyclic curves. These cyclic curves allow us to have input as the stress range applied on the net stress range applied on the rivet joint, and as output we have the local peak elastoplastic peak strain range. So this is what we call the component cyclic curve. We have also the material cyclic curve that was the input for our simulations. We have also derived these equations for the stress intensity factors for, again, different clamping stresses and friction coefficients. And in we adopt polynomials just to fit the experimental, the numerical results. Afterwards, we did a lot of simulations, and in the paper I told you before, there are 16 simulations where we combine different input, different inputs, and we look for the outputs. We have one reference simulation, and then we have all the comparisons that allow us to make a kind of sensitivity analysis. So this is, in our Monte Carlo simulations, we use a software that is very simple to use because it runs on Excel spreadsheets. it was the at-risk software. So we can define easily our input in different ways. So we adopted, for example, the clamping stresses log normal distribution for the C coefficient of the Paris law log normal distribution. For other cases, like the friction coefficient and crack initiation definition, we don't have so much information about this in the literature. So I use a more empirical distribution, which is very simple to define. We need just define a most likely value, a minimum expected value, and the maximum expected value, and you have a kind of triangular density function. So using this, we were able to compute some outputs during or making 10,000 computations. We were able to compute the strain amplitude, the number of cycles to crack initiation, the number of cycles for crack propagation, and the total fatigue life. I think I'm going, I'm almost at the end so of my time. So I will make some extra comments. So using that software, we can also make we can also assess the goodness of fit of many statistical distributions applied to our outputs. So we found, for example, that the strain, the local strain amplitude follows a variable distribution, taking into account different statistical tests, as you can see here. We did also that for other outputs, like the total fatigue life, and for that we found that log normal distribution, which is actually used in many, for example, design codes, follows. It's a good density distribution describing our total fatigue life. Then. The final goal of our study was to define the SEN fields for our riveted joint. So in these slides or in these graphs, you can see the experimental data and the estimation of our probabilistic SEN field. So you can see the initiation, propagation, and total life. So we can see that in this case, what we found from this analysis is that the initiation life was the controlling fatigue damage mechanism. The fatigue crack propagation, despite having some effect, is not actually so significant. I would say if we neglect that part in this riveted joint, we would have a very good and conservative estimation for our SEN experimental data. So afterwards, we did some sensitivity studies. For example, testing, I think I don't have time enough to go too much in details as regards these last sensitivity studies, but we test different different distributions for the inputs. For example, one key aspect is the clamping stress. And we found that in our rivet joint, we should have an average clamping stress very small, around 25 megapascal. But it could go somehow higher to 50, we will have still consistent prediction of the SEN field. But of course, we did this tool that was programmed in an Excel spread file. We can play easily now with our model and make these sensitivity studies and understand what really is going on and what is the most important parameters and those that we need to pay more attention. I would say clamping stresses, friction, Also, the elastoplastic analysis, we also did some analysis. So we have now final concluding remarks. Probably I would expect some lessons learned from our study. So despite, in our case, we accounted for crack initiation and propagation, we found that crack initiation was the controlling mechanism for our joint. That was the crack initiation process that give us a consistent slope for our SEN field. Friction and clamping effects are very important, and are not easy to quantify experimentally, and more importantly on site. It's very difficult to evaluate it on site. So this is an open research point that many of you could be interested to follow. Then I would say we have some more specific concluding remarks. For example, it was very interesting that the elastoplastic strain that was computed followed a wavelet distribution, which is a very common distribution in mechanics and the strength of materials field. And of course, I applied this methodology to a very simple case study, but you can extend this to more complex situations. And also, the fatigue model could be really more advanced. Of course, it will need more programming, and also you need to define more input distributions for your model. So I think that's all for my presentation.